Hello and welcome to my channel The Conceptual Codon. Here we discuss about various medical concepts and today's concept is Quincy or peritonsillar abscess. So generally abscess means collection of pus. So in peritonsillar abscess the collection of pus occurs in the peritonsillar space. So what is peritonsillar space? The peritonsillar space is between the capsule of the tonsil and the superior constrictor muscle. Now to understand this, this is a schematic diagram. Here is the tonsils, the bilaterally palatine tonsils, and these are the tonsillar crypts. This is the uvula and these are the soft palates. Now on the bed of the tonsil, that is the lateral aspect of the tonsil, is the tonsillar capsule. So this part is the tonsillar capsule. Then is the pharyngobasilar fossa and then buccopharyngeal fossa. Between the pharyngobasilar fossa and the buccopharyngeal fossa lies a muscle, that is the superior constrictor muscle. So this part I am shading with red is the superior constrictor muscle. So the peritonsillar space is between the capsule of the tonsil and the superior constrictor muscle. So the part which is shaded with blue color is the peritonsillar space. Now this peritonsillar space contains a vein, that is the paratonsillar vein. Now coming to the etiology of peritonsillar abscess, it can have two scenarios. One is it can follow an attack of acute tonsillitis, or it can occur in de novo patient who have no history of acute tonsillitis. Usually the acute tonsillitis occurs in children, but the peritonsillar abscess usually common in case of adults. The organisms responsible for this kind of peritonsillar abscess are Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, and sometimes the anaerobic organisms are also involved. Usually what happens, this organism, that is Staphylococcus, Streptococcus and anaerobic organisms, infect one of the tonsillar crypts. One of the tonsillar crypts, usually the bigger one, that is the crypta magna, gets infected and it is then sealed off. These are the tonsillar crypts present here. These are the tonsillar crypts. So tonsillar crypts are inside the tonsil. It is in the medial aspect of the tonsil. So the infecting organism infects one of the bigger tonsillar crypts, that is called the crypta magna first, and then it forms an abscess which is inside the tonsil, which is called an intratonsillar abscess. This is the intratonsillar abscess. And then they burst through the tonsillar capsule, and when they burst through the tonsillar capsule, it reaches in the peritonsillar space. Just between the tonsillar capsule and the superior constrictor muscle is the peritonsillar space. So bursting through the tonsillar capsule, the pus will reach into the peritonsillar space and set up an inflammation, that is called peritonsillitis, and ultimately collection of pus will be there in the peritonsillar space, and we will name it then a peritonsillar abscess. So this is the etiopathogenesis of peritonsillar abscess. Next is the clinical features. The clinical features can be divided into some general clinical features and some local clinical features. General clinical features usually due to septicemia, and it resembles the features of any acute infection. These are fever with chills and rigor, pain in the body and head, that is body ache, headache, general malaise, nausea, and sometimes constipation may be there. Local symptoms are mainly important. There will be severe pain in throat. There will be difficulty and pain during swallowing, that is odynophagia. The odynophagia will be so marked that the patient cannot swallow his or her own saliva, and there will be dribbling of the saliva from the corners of the mouth. The patient's voice will be affected, and it will be thick and muffled voice, which is called hot potato voice. Here the patient will be struggling to pronounce the vowels. There will be septicemia as discussed earlier. So septicemia will cause a foul breath. There will be ipsilateral earache. Why there will be ipsilateral earache? This is due to referred pain via the glossopharyngeal nerve. So The part of the ear is supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. Also, the tonsils are supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve. So, ipsilateral earache in peritonsillar abscess will occur due to the referred pain via the glossopharyngeal nerve. And there will be trismus due to the spasm of the pterygoid muscle. The pterygoid muscles are situated adjacent to the superior constrictor muscle. This is in the superior constrictor muscle. Is this is the superior constrictor muscle part. Now the adjacent to the superior constrictor muscle lies the pterygoid muscles. So in peritonsillar abscess, which is collection of pus between tonsil and the superior constrictor muscle, the pterygoid muscles will also be affected, and there will be spasm of the pterygoid muscles, which will lead to trismus. On examination, in case of a normal or healthy person, we will find, and this is the uvula, which is in the midline, and these are the pillars of the tonsil, which are not swollen and not congested. But in case of peritonsillar abscess patient, the uvula will be swollen and edematous and pushed to the opposite side. The tonsil, pillars and soft palate will be congested and swollen. Now the tonsils will not be swollen because they will get buried beneath the swollen pillars of the tonsils. There will be cervical lymphadenopathy and enlarged upper jugular or jugulodigastric lymph nodes. Regarding investigations, there will be some radiological investigations and pathological, that is needle aspiration. In the radiological investigation, we will do CCT, that is contrast enhanced CT scan, and MRI. Both will show the abscess and its extent. Needle aspiration, if on needle aspiration pus is obtained, it is a case of peritonsillar abscess, the diagnosis is confirmed, and we will go for culture. If on needle aspiration no pus is coming out, then probably it is a case of peritonsillar cellulitis. On culture, this type of picture is seen in case of a peritonsillar abscess. During treatment, obviously in peritonsillar abscess, the patient should first be hospitalized. Then for combating dehydration, IV fluid should be given. There will be dehydration because the patient is suffering from odynophagia. So the patient cannot swallow, or there is pain during swallowing. So there will be dehydration. To combat the dehydration, the IV fluids will be given. To combat the infections, antibiotics, IV antibiotics will be given. Paracetamol like analgesics are also given for relief of the pain or temperature if it is there. But in some cases of peritonsillar abscess, higher analgesics like pethidine is also given. Maintain the oral hygiene by hydrogen peroxide or saline mouthwash. And the definitive treatment is incision and drainage. So the abscess is opened at the point of maximum bulge. So this is very important. This should be remembered, that the abscess is opened at the point of maximum bulge. That is in the dependent part. The abscess is opened at the dependent part. Now this can be regarded as a point just lateral to the point of junction of anterior pillar with a line drawn through the base of the uvula. So to understand this, this is a picture where this line is drawn through the base of the uvula, and this is the anterior pillar of the tonsil. These lines are intersecting at this point. Now just lateral to this point, the incision is given in case of a incision and drainage of peritonsillar abscess. So this is the incision and drainage part. Next, they are with the tonsils will be removed, that is tonsillectomy. Some surgeons prefer doing tonsillectomy 4 to 6 weeks following an attack of peritonsillar abscess. So naturally an attack of peritonsillar abscess has occurred, and 4 to 6 weeks later the tonsillectomy will be performed. This is called interval tonsillectomy, as there is a definite interval between the attack of peritonsillar abscess and the process of tonsillectomy. But some surgeons prefer to do tonsillectomy instead of doing the incision and drainage. Now this is called abscess tonsillectomy or hot tonsillectomy. But there are some disadvantages of this type of abscess or hot tonsillectomy, because there will be risk of rupture of the abscess during anesthesia, or there may be chances of heavy bleeding during the operation. There may be some complications of peritonsillar abscess as well, like parapharyngeal abscess. Their parapharyngeal space is situated adjacent to the peritonsillar space, so peritonsillar abscess can lead to parapharyngeal abscess. Edema of the larynx, there may be septicemia, and due to aspiration of pus or aspiration of blood, there will be there can be pneumonitis or lung abscess. So this is a picture of peritonsillar abscess, where you can see this part is the uvula, which is pushed to the opposite side of the lesion, opposite side of the pathology, and it is swollen. And this part is the tonsil and the pillars, which are enlarged, and it is depicted here. So that's it. Thank you for listening.